change not. You look at me, I can change. I can change from being evil to good. I can change from being good to evil. I can change from lying to telling the truth. I can change from telling the truth to telling what? Now that means I can go back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. God can't do that. This is what we were talking to a couple about last night. We said, God can't do that. God is holy. He cannot be evil. Nor can he sanction evil. God is righteous. He cannot be unrighteous. God is godly. He cannot be ungodly. God is truth. He cannot tell a lie. So there are things about God we must understand that were manifest in Jesus Christ that all of us have to understand. He can't do it. So if I stand before God, look at me for a moment, I'm trying to illustrate something. If I stand before God and he can't go back and forth, and he has said what he has said concerning his expectations of me, and I have not met those expectations, he can't change it. Even if you went to court, the judge is given latitude of judgment. If I go to court and I am convicted of a crime, he is given the latitude called sentencing guidelines. Listen to a member of law enforcement now. And within those sentencing guidelines, he can determine as to whether or not he's going to sentence me to the minimum or to the maximum. In God's word, when we stand before God, just like the judge has to deal with the individual that stands before him in court, when I stand before God, God has to deal with me strictly according to his word. So understand, if you believe God and I believe God, let's understand the seriousness of our walk with God and our relationship with God. God cannot go contrary to his word. Even the judge on the bench in our civil and criminal courts has to stick with, someone say, guidelines. And if he goes beyond those guidelines and violates his order of jurisprudence as a jurist, then he, of course, can be brought in question by what is referred to as the JTC. What does the JTC stand for? The Judicial Tenure Commission. How do I know? Because I served with members of the JTC when I served on the ADB board. And then he is called in question as to whether or not he has executed his office according to those rules that govern his conduct and such. Please let us understand, God cannot lie. God cannot change. What God has said, that is what his expectation is. Now, can God forgive? Someone say, can God forgive? Yes, he can forgive. But understand, God can forgive, but then we must ask for his what? Forgiveness. Can God reconcile? Of course he can reconcile. The reconciliation of God is through the ministry of our Lord and Savior who? So I am a representative of God in Jesus Christ. I do not sit here and teach from the Bible to try to weave the scriptures so that people will accept them. I have to teach and preach what the scripture says, just as in, if I can use this illustration, the judge is supposed to sit on the bench and he is supposed to interpret the law. The common law that came to us from England that has been, of course, no doubt tailored for American civil and criminal society or American civil society to deal with criminal and civil behavior, he has to deal with that as such. He's supposed to interpret the law. It's my job to sit down and give the right division, the proper interpretation of the scriptures, not my private interpretation, to the people of God. So after God has given you the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit will guide you to do what the scripture said. Just as When there are civil laws, we're supposed to conduct ourselves within the context of what? Civil law. And if there are criminal laws, we're not supposed to be guilty of breaking the laws of criminality. Otherwise, we are called a what? A criminal. The child of God is supposed to conduct himself with the Holy Spirit within the confines of the Word of God. Otherwise, we are referred to as transgressors. Can the church say amen? Amen. So this is the reason why we're getting ready to read this, is because these were questions that came to me just the other night, last night as a matter of fact. So I need to address this because a couple insisted that we meet. We were up till 12:30 in the morning in here dealing with this situation, and we wanted to show the seriousness of what is referred to as the marriage relationship and what the Bible says also about the single relationship. Praise the Lord. So there are benefits in being married and there are benefits in being single. There's nothing wrong with being single. There's nothing wrong with being married. But there is something wrong with conduct that is unbecoming of a person who is a Christian that is single, and conduct that is unbecoming of a person who is married and is a Christian, and all the people see it. So our verse number, let's start with verse number 4. This is where we need to go, just to get straight. Turn to someone and say, let's get straight to the point. Verse 4, 5, and 6. Let's read. Marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled, but whoremongers and adulterers God will judge. Let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as ye have, for he hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee, so that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. And all the people said, now keep this in mind. Verse number 4, he says, marriage is what? Honorable. Marriage is still an honorable estate. And this is clearly an institution, may I make this point? It is an institution that God himself established in the beginning between a man and a woman, male and female. Adam was their name. The fifth chapter of the book of Genesis says, and he called their name Adam. Adam is the name of the human family. Then he gave Adam the authority to name, of course, his wife, and he did. He named his wife Eve, which means, someone say, the mother of all living. And so we should understand that this is the institution that God himself established. The only other thing that God himself established as such, if we can use this as an illustration, I don't want to take anything away from God and all the scriptures, he did give Moses the pattern for the tabernacle in the book of Genesis. It was a type of the church. When he gave the pattern for the tabernacle in the temple, it was a type of the church. And then Jesus, when he came, said, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So this is why we tell people who are getting married today that you need to understand that it is very dangerous to play with the marriage relationship. Are you listening to me? Because you will play your way into the lake of fire. And that's not because I'm trying to frighten you, but we all know that the requirements of the scripture is that we follow peace with all men in the book of Hebrews, holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. We also all know we have received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Someone said it's power to be a witness. First of all, it's power for God to produce what he has always desired in man and women. Women, this includes you too. This is not exclusive. The term man is, of course, referring to Homo sapiens, or it is a generic term. So don't think that I'm basically being gender specific when I say man, or I'm excluding you, or I'm discriminating against you. But keep in mind, he gave us the baptism of the Holy Spirit to produce, someone say, holiness. This is what we have it for. So it will produce the lifestyle. the conversation.